we're going to be talking about Tremont nail factory again. The team of consultants provided by Mass Development has been busy at work. They've been analyzing and conceptualizing, and we're going to see what their concept looks like tonight. They're going to do this in ways that preserve the history and make the property productive again, albeit in more modern terms. This is the final presentation by this team, so ask your questions. And know that this is not the last step, far from it. After this is submitted as a report, we need to start acting on the ideas and make things real. You know, I believe that visualizing an outcome and keeping it up and real makes it happen. And I think what we want to do is see if we can create that vision tonight and have that concept presented to us and see if we can make it as real as we can. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jeremy Lake of Union Studios, the head of the consulting team that has been working on this as provided by Mass Development.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jeremy Lake with Union Studio. By way of just sharing with you what we're going to be talking about tonight, this is our agenda. I'm going to start by reintroducing the project team for those of you that weren't here at the last presentation. Talk through the process that we took getting here today. For the sake of people that weren't at the first presentation, I'm going to recap what we talked about in the first one. But for the sake of those that were here, I'm going to try to do it sort of quickly and efficiently. I won't be going through every point on every slide that we did that time. I'm going to just give everybody the background and the context that we were utilizing the material for today. Then following that, we'll get into the new information, the things we've been working on since the last presentation, which was in early March, I think. We've done a feasibility analysis, looking at some regulatory issues and the market feasibility of a lot of what we're proposing. So we'll talk about those things. We'll share with you the preliminary concepts we came up with that we reviewed as a team internally, based on a lot of the feedback and input we've been getting from everyone. And then talk about the proposed vision plan itself. And you'll see at the end, the goal is to have some discussion again. So again, to reiterate, tonight isn't the final step. We still get to produce a report that would summarize our suggestions, our findings, this whole process. So the hope is that tonight there's still an opportunity for folks to give us some other input, some other ideas before we've sort of finalized the vision plan itself. To reintroduce the project team, on behalf of the town of Wareham, we've been working with Ken, Derek, and Peter. For Mass Development, tonight we have Ed Starczak here. Laura Barrett has also been very involved with the project but could not make it tonight. On behalf of Union Studio, I'm Jeremy Lake. I'm also joined by Joel Vanderweel, who's been very involved with the project. From Peregrine Group, we have Eric Bush, who will actually be coming up at one point later to present with me on a few items. They've been doing a lot of the sort of market analysis and putting on the developer's hat to help guide and help us understand what seems reasonable and feasible out here. And last but not least, Joe Longo from Horsley Whitman, a civil engineering firm based in Sandwich. They've been doing a lot of the background research in terms of regulatory constraints, other challenges on site. So again, this is the totality of our team, and most of us are here tonight, which is good as well. And just as a quick reminder of why we are here, we've worked on a number of what we'll call vision plans in a number of different townships. Every one of these are examples of ones we've done with Mass Development, funded by Mass Development. A number of these also did involve Eric or Horsley Whitman as well. And it was a similar set of challenges where there might be underutilized parcels that are either owned by a town or not owned by a town, but are certainly seen as something that would be a real catalyst for some change or improving local conditions or taking advantage of historic assets. So again, this is everyone's a little bit different, everyone's a little bit unique, but we do have a track record of doing these types of projects again with a public process, similar to what we've been doing here in Wareham. So the process itself, pre-design, we started working on this project back in December and January. That was what we called our pre-design stage. That was us just sort of gathering information, visiting the site, photographs, meeting with the group from the town, and just getting a better understanding of what they saw being the opportunities and constraints that are out here. In February, we had a series of initial stakeholder meetings. I'll talk about those a little bit more later. Those were some very focused meetings with folks that have a lot of knowledge or a lot of history on the site. But we've also been having ongoing input from the community through an online website called Urbanize. I'll share that information with you at the end as well, because that's intended to kind of be an ongoing process even beyond tonight. We had our first public presentation back in March. Again, in then the balance of March and into April, we did our feasibility analysis and worked on some preliminary concepts that evolved into decisions made on us coming up with a draft vision plan that we'll be talking about tonight. We're here tonight at that second public presentation. As I mentioned, our final step, which is probably what will play out by now in the next coming weeks, we'll be taking whatever feedback we get tonight, incorporating that, turning this into some sort of report that then has the ability to live on and help guide the project moving forward. So again, as a brief recap of what we talked about in March, we started by obviously just identifying where the site is in the larger Wareham community. Most of you are probably aware of where it is, but it's here fairly central in Wareham. On the whole, 195-25 bypassing Wareham here. The Crane Road Highway 28 comes through here. The site is just off of that. Main Street as it connects down to the 6. So again, it's in a fairly central location, sort of midway between the sort of historic downtown area and the sort of more auto-centric commercial areas out at the edge of town. And then looking at it a little more closely, again, here's the project site. We know there was an earlier study done by, I don't remember who it was, maybe ULI, that looked at downtown Wareham, and they really described the Main Street core area as being from green to green. So extending from Center Park at the northern edge of Main Street all the way down to, is it Bess or Bessie? I always get it wrong, whichever one it is. Bessie, at the southern end of town. And as you can see, the project site is sort of just at that northern terminus. Again, we're thinking of this creating a northern anchor, if you will, almost to the historic core Main Street area here in Wareham. Then again, dialing in even deeper, again, the project site is here, and the tones are meant to represent the various uses that are in the immediate context. And so the red represent the commercial uses that are along Cranberry Highway. The blue represent various cultural and civic uses, the Old Town Hall, churches, the Historic Society campus that's here, daycare, a potential Cranberry Museum that, is considering bringing online. So again, the point being that it sits amongst a variety of uses, residential, retail, cultural, we'll be coming back to that, but again, just giving a sense of its context and its location. Again, these are things we do to help us better understand the specifics of the project. You guys live here and know all these things, but for us, it's helpful to do these diagrams to make sure we're understanding it as well as we can. The site itself, again, most of you are probably aware of the site, but it's really a campus of buildings, a number of historic facilities that were used for the tree, the nail manufacturing process, a more modern 1970s building at the edge. But again, what's really great is that collection of buildings, often these kinds of sites, buildings, it's not unusual for buildings to be added over time, but for whatever reason here, they kind of added up to make a really nice sort of seamless campus feel. The fact that they're all similar massing, similar materials, similar colors. Even in its current sort of dilapidated, underutilized condition, it's really kind of a wonderful and very interesting place. And the town actually back in 2009 had a report done, a conditions assessment by vendors Corey and Spencer. This is like a 400-page document for those of you who haven't seen it. It provides a lot of great information on the history of the site, the existing condition of the buildings are out there, what sort of steps should be taken to stabilize those buildings. So this provided a really great starting point for our work, let us really get a good understanding of the history of the site. And a lot of those recommendations were things we used again as a launching point for the efforts that we've done here so far. And last time we went through each of the different buildings then and what the report talked about. Again, the overall site is roughly 7 acres. The oldest three buildings are the main factory building, freight building out on the water, and the office building that's right on Elm Street. Those date to 1848. Operations have been out here 30 years prior to that. A lot of the buildings from before then burned down in the fire, which is why these were all then built and established in 1848. And then a number of other buildings, those smaller buildings were added over time through the 50s. Steel building added in the 70s. We pointed out a few of the key site assets that are out there. One thing we termed the yard is really the space between the historic buildings. We'll be talking about that quite a bit tonight. It's kind of a neat space in its existing condition, but can really be played up and made to be kind of its own unique special place out here. And also pointing out there is Parker's Mill Dam, fish ladder, and the flume along the edge. There's all these neat little public or natural moments that occur in conjunction with the site as well, that we wanted to make sure we were capitalizing on with what we were proposing here tonight. And for those of you that don't know, while the nail factory isn't on in a local historic district. It is on the National Register of Historic Places. And in fact, there's also a plaque out there that points out that the American Society for Metals has designated this a historic landmark as well, for the longevity of how long they've been producing nails here and the way that they produce nails here. So again, the site has a lot of historical significance, which again, as you are probably well aware of. In terms of the existing conditions, just a few constraints we were up against that we had to make ourselves aware of. There are designated wetlands on the southern portion of the site. There's a lot of regulations and restrictions related to wetlands, which make nothing but all the sense in the world. There's a bunch of setbacks off of there that come up with their own sense of that creates its own set of regulations and needs. The reality is that there's existing disturbance, this black dash line, obviously the wetlands are up to the buildings and the parking areas. You have flexibility of what you can do in those areas. So what all that is to say is that everything you see that we propose tonight is largely in the same areas that the buildings are existing today. They weren't proposing coming further south into the areas that are naturally sensitive areas. Likewise, there are also regulations in terms of how close you can, what you can do adjacent to the river. There's a 200-foot river setback, and that has its own set of constraints, and I'll talk about what that means in a moment. Beyond that, there's also this light blue line is the floodplain as established by FEMA. It's at an elevation of 15. That's the area within which, if there were major storm events, there might be flooding. So again, another layer of regulation and concern you need to be aware of. And then finally, we have this sort of top left-hand corner of the site, which is above the floodplain and out of the wetland setbacks, out of the river setbacks. So it is the most flexible portion of the site, if you will. And to summarize what that all means, the area in blue, which is within the 200-foot setback, riverfront setback, new construction is not allowed, but renovation is possible. So the good news is that's pretty much where most of the historic buildings are in any case. But it does suggest that the best strategy moving forward is to capitalize on those buildings, reuse those buildings. I think some people thought, well, wouldn't it be great if we just tore those down and built a cool new waterfront restaurant right there? The reality is that the regulations wouldn't allow you to do that even if you wanted to. And it makes nothing but sense to keep them anyways because of their historic value. But the regulations got to do this way in the case.
Can you rephrase it? You said that the new construction is not allowed area. If they were torn down, then nothing could be built there?
You couldn't build something in its place. The next zone is light blue zone, which is the area that's outside of 200 foot, but within the floodplain area. New construction is possible if you were to elevate that new construction above that elevation of 15. So the good news is for instance, where that existing steel building is, that lowest corner of it is at an elevation of 14. So you're only a foot off from where you would need to be. And most of the rest of that zone is that centralized parking area, which you'll see is something that we're actually proposing to retain. So with a little bit of work, you can make this buildable area. And then lastly, this upper corner, again, outside all of the restricted areas above the floodplain area, so new construction is possible in this upper corner of the site. Next, we talked about all of the stakeholder input that we got in those February sessions. Again, I'm just gonna summarize this quickly. We got initial input from town officials, local business owners, residents, commission members. To summarize a lot of the key takeaways, again, we were able to establish that the site is in fact historically significant. It's not just old, it's significant. The things that happened out here, the history of this place, are things that need to be respected and emulated. We did come to understand that there were all these layers of regulations that we had to digest and better understand, which that last diagram was meant to sort of summarize. In terms of the challenges out here, access is a real challenge. The fact that it's close to Cranberry Highway, but just off of Cranberry Highway. It's close to Main Street, but it's just off of Main Street. And Elm Street, as it comes across the front of the site, the dam is in such poor condition at the moment that it's closed to vehicular traffic. So there's very limited opportunities of getting to the site. Its visibility is a bit of a challenge, but again, that's just a challenge to be resolved. Obviously, there are going to be costs affiliated with bringing these buildings from their current condition into a condition where they can be utilized. That will be a legitimate challenge. And again, the number of regulations that are here are, again, something else that needs to be better understood and that will need to be addressed as the project moves through. But on the flip side of that, the opportunities, obviously the setting, the unique setting here, the historic campus of factory buildings is really special. It's right on the river, so it's actually got some really wonderful places to be. The fact that the flume and the fish ladder comes through, there's some really cool spots to stand and listen to the water rushing through. The history that's here, again, it's a very unique place. It can be a real draw for folks. And the location within the larger Wareham community, again, that being at the northern end of Main Street, it can be plugged into the sort of central core area of Wareham. I think those are all great opportunities for the site. And lastly, when we talked about potential uses out here, a number of different things were proposed and continue to be proposed. But again, they all seem to fall under either cultural, retail, or residential uses. And in the end, what we think makes the most sense is to imagine development here or redevelopment here that has a mixture of all three of those things, creating a sort of cohesive whole, a mix of uses that reinforce one another, provide 24-hour use of the site. And again, that diagram I showed earlier, the immediately adjacent uses in the local context, it's that same mix of uses, so it's really reinforcing the existing context and things going on in the local community. So again, I put this up here just again as a quick reminder, renovation possible, new construction possible, wetlands and south. And this is how we left the first public presentation, was our just quick initial thoughts based on what we have heard so far, which was to say, reutilizing the historic buildings. The purple was meant to represent potential cultural uses, so the oldest buildings and the biggest volume spaces would have some sort of civic use, and we'll get into that in more detail. But some of the buildings, the smaller structures, or some of the additions to those older buildings in the center might have retail uses, where they could have a, you know, they could feed upon one each other to create a critical mass, if you will, of use there in the middle. Thinking of that space between the buildings, we've been calling the yard, and some of the spaces along the water's edge, really thinking of those as public open spaces to be used, not just a parking lot, but actually a place to host events, to host activities. And making the connections between all of those is important. Preserving that centralized parking area as parking moving forward, again, it makes a lot of sense to do so. And then in this upper corner, we said that if there was a potential for new construction, some potential for residential on the site, we think it would be in this sort of upper third of the site, again, potentially taking down that metal building. So again, these were where our head was at coming out of that first meeting. But we really hadn't really developed ideas as to what that really looks like, what that really means. But that's where we did leave off with that first part of the presentation. So our second round of stakeholder input, the first was really the comments that we got out of the first public presentation when we were here in March. Folks were generally supportive of the ideas, certainly a lot of support for the notion of doing a museum on site and really thinking of that not only as a museum to the nail factory, but maybe a museum that talks about more of the regional impacts or regional things going on. Maybe the entirety with someone built the Iron Trail of Southeast Massachusetts, but obviously they needed to get their materials from somewhere and how all those things are interconnected. It was suggested that we think about preserving the blacksmith and tool shops that are still out there. They're not in the main factory space, but they're in some of those smaller additions off of the main building. They can be used for things like exhibitions, or again, they're there, why tear that all out to just put something else in its place. There might be a good way of using that. It would also be a nice connection back with Tremont Nail Company. Again, Tremont Nail Company still does exist. And it might be a neat way of having them come out and interact with the community that's still here. Utilize the metal building for affordable artist studios or large events. Again, we'll talk about it a little bit more as we go forward, but we've looked at it sort of both ways, reusing the building, not reusing the building. Again, it's there and it probably makes sense to try to use it in the short term. And we'll talk about that a little bit more, but a number of folks brought up that idea in that first public presentation. Kayak launch that's out there would really be better if it was a dock. Currently, when the tide is low, you would have no ability to get to the launch, so it's a little bit tricky in terms of trying to actually use it on a consistent basis. So the dock would be really helpful. A lot of folks have reiterated the need to repair that dam so we can get the traffic moving through there again and just make sure that the dam is in condition. And again, really think about the relation to merchants. There's a number of existing businesses down the street on Main Street. We want to make sure that anything we propose here complements those uses, doesn't compete with those uses, so that it's not improving this by draining the other, if you will. And then we've also had ongoing input through the co-organized website. We're up to 87 comments as of this morning. And again, without going through all of these, folks have been generally again supportive of what we've been talking about so far. A number of uses that are comparable to the things we've been talking about, you know, microbreweries, waterfront restaurants, museums, possible artist studios. Again, reiterating the need to preserve the historic character of the site, maybe utilizing a dock as a launch point for historic river tours. Maybe there's ways of taking advantage of the access to the rail. Maybe there's a trolley to downtown. Again, need to repair the dam, need to remediate the contamination. obviously as an industrial site, there is contamination out there that does need to be addressed. That would be one of the ongoing challenges again as it moves forward. And again, if someone had a good idea of maybe relocating the metal building, if it's not to be reused here, maybe there's another site where we could move it and utilize it. So, transitioning on to our feasibility analysis. The first thing we looked at were regulatory issues. And I'm going to speak to these in a very general sense, but if folks have very specific questions about the regulatory things, when we have a discussion at the end, we can certainly try to address those. Joe's here, so we can certainly try to address those. But I'm just going to give you the kind of architect's understanding of regulations, which is the very general. So redevelopment is possible for the historic buildings, but there is a process and it will take time. As we mentioned, there are wetlands, riverfront areas, and deep salt marshes out here. All of those have their own buffers, all of those have their own regulations, all of those have their own review processes that need to be going through. But because there are existing conditions, existing disturbances out there, there is some flexibility, which is good and helpful. These regulations are both at the state and local level, so again, there might be multiple tiers, multiple layers of review needed. And as we mentioned, portions of the site within the FEMA flood zone, so again, that comes with its own limits and impacts the kind of insurance you may need for flood insurance and how those areas are managed. And redevelopment of existing structures within the flood zone, so again, mostly those historic structures, you're limited to improvements that are 50% of the appraised value. So that's what that basically means is that, let's say any one of those given structures is worth $10,000 today, you're limited to $5,000 of improvements on that $10,000 structure. Now it's worth $15,000, now you can go back in for $7,500 worth of improvements. Point being is that you have to do an incremental set of improvements. So it will take time. It will require incremental improvements and patience over a stretch of time. You can't just kind of come and say, I've got the cash, I want to turn this barn into a microbrewery, and it's not going to happen overnight. There's a process here. We are looking into whether or not there is some flexibility with this because of the specifics of the site. We're not sure yet. So for the time being, we'll say this is something that will need to be understood and tackled as part of the process. As we mentioned, the potential new build areas are above or close to being above the flood zone. So that's good news that the upper third of the site is potentially available for new development. One thing we hadn't talked about previously, but the good news is this site is not listed as a rare species habitat, so there's no unique turtle nesting things going on here that kind of totally squash your ability to redevelop it, so that the site is available for redevelopment from that perspective. And the site does have access to utilities, public water, sewer, electric, gas, so that's all good. And then finally, the redevelopment will utilize best practices for mitigation. So anything we do in terms of erosion and sediment control during the redevelopment, and certainly the stormwater management, with whatever's put out there, again, we'll all utilize best practices. In a lot of ways, we'll be very supportive and sympathetic to the fact that there are wetlands right adjacent to the site. So again, in many ways, the redeveloped site will be better, if you will, than probably the current condition in terms of how stormwater is managed and so on. Market feasibility. This is where I pass it on to Eric.
So, hi everyone. I'm introduced to Eric Bush. I work for a company called the Paradigm Group. And my role on this team is really to look at it from a development perspective. So my background and experience is with developing sites like this, historic buildings, waterfront sites, contaminated sites, and most of my time and energy is spent on the financing side. So when coupled with designers and planners, often I'm the bad guy in the room who says, you can't do that, that's not gonna work, and that just kind of killed the dreams that come up. So what we thought was important is, as we went through this entire process, to really also add to the regulatory side, also looking at the economics, looking at the market, understanding at the end of this, we want something that's implementable and able to be achieved as a combination of philanthropy, but also as the market would allow it to happen. So in looking at the market, go ahead. We looked at kind of big picture and then coming down to the smaller picture, starting what's happening in the region, what's happening in the world of real estate development right now. But looking particularly at what's going on in the South Coast, what's happening along the Cape, what's happening in Plymouth County, what projects are working, what projects are in planning, what projects have stalled, So that helps inform really the picture of what the possibilities are. And then we really started flowing that down into the local. So looking at what's here. So expanding the footprint from Wareham just a little bit outside and saying, what are our rents? What are our for sale housing products looking like? What kind of vacancy is there in the commercial space that's available? And really then talking with, as part of the stakeholder discussions, talking with local businesses about what's working, what are the challenges, hearing from some potential developers about what they're interested in. And then kind of continuing to look at that and then coupling that with many of the items that Jeremy had mentioned, what we were hearing, what people would like to see, what their wants are, what the needs are, what's missing in town. So with that context, it's sort of part of the same process as we get into looking at some of what the proposed options are.
Great. Thank you. So that was the market feasibility. Next, we're going to walk you through the preliminary concepts that we developed, that we're exploring some of these ideas. And Eric's actually going to stay up here as well. Basically, with each concept, I'll be providing sort of what we were looking at or thinking about from a design perspective, and then Eric will be able to then provide the counter in terms of how the market sees that or what the feasibility of those various schemes were from a market perspective. The first one, this is the same slide I showed earlier, just reiterating this idea. The preliminary thoughts of the civic uses, the retail at the core, potential residential at the edge, parking in the middle. Again, when we shared this, it was a concept that seemed to resonate, and talking about it internally, it seemed to make a lot of sense. But again, what that really looked like and how that developed is what the next phase was really about. So this was the first option that we talked about, which for the historic structures, again, it should look largely familiar. The idea was that the larger portions of the historic buildings would have civic uses. And by civic uses, what we mean is those could be event spaces, they could host exhibitions, they could host music performances. Certainly the factory building main space is this huge volume of space. There'll be certain sort of events and activities that make sense in there, versus the freight building has a sort of smaller, more intimate scale. And so we're thinking that's, you know, weddings and parties and things along those lines. And so while we are proposing two different event spaces, we think they have different roles in that capacity. And it's also not to say that if someone decided that they did want to come and open a children's museum, that they couldn't utilize the main factory space to make a museum and to really capitalize on that space. What we didn't want it to become was, you know, thinking about it being converted to residential studios, where suddenly you're taking that big space and chopping it up and dividing it into smaller spaces and having to open up all the roof and windows in, really losing that historic character of the space. So it's really trying to respect the building that's there, find a use that can make the most of the space that's there. For the spaces in the middle, again, we were thinking of those as retail uses, and when we say retail uses, the kind of thing that came to mind as being reasonable here would be things like a microbrewery or a little cafe on the water. Certainly, a number of folks suggested the notion of paddle sports, you know, rentals and sales. Namaskar Kayak Center, for those of you who don't know, is going to start operating out of here, I think, in a few weeks, offering rentals. They'll be operating out of this building and utilizing the public boat launch. But we think that's a use that makes perfect sense here in the long term as well. And so again, thinking of those things as being concentrated sort of around this core area. The office building, again, at this point, we hadn't really figured out what it would be. Maybe it's offices, or maybe it's like part of the museum, or whatever it might be. But the real variable that you'll see between all of the schemes that we proposed was the disposition of the residential component of the project. And so in this first option, we looked at a single large multifamily building, more or less where the footprint of the current metal building is. Depending on the size of the units in the building, that's anywhere from probably 35 to 50 units. So you get quite a few units in there. And what all this math over here was looking at was us trying to be realistic about parking demand, satisfy those things on site. So in each of these schemes, we thought we had a realistic approach to how the parking might work out here. So that was the first option. I will say that the pros from our perspective, one, brings a lot of residents, which can be good. Those are folks that are utilizing whatever's going on the other half of the site and they're providing that 24-hour use of the site. The challenge we saw in this one was that being such a large singular building, it feels like it's out of scale, it feels like it's out of context, both to the local community, but even on the site itself. And you can see it almost dwarfs the main factory building. And so While there are strategies for how you bring down the scale of the building and break up its massing, I will say that we were very much concerned about the scale of that potential building. So,
yeah, just to reinforce that, and from the development perspective, to start with the large multifamily building at 30 or 50 units, yeah, obviously this is a big step. This is a potentially a $10 million investment, order of magnitude, with the rest of the site not complete. You know, if that was the first step, it would be very difficult. Just because you're talking about a major investment, you know, someone who's got options of doing things in other places, it's a fairly high level of risk to be in a site like this where there's other things happening that influence. You have the railroad tracks, you have the building that, you know, if you look at this again going right away, you're kind of putting your faith in everything else happening and becoming a very active, great place to be in order for that building to work. And what we found, when we pull the lens back a little bit from the site, new construction multifamily is, although I just set traffic forever getting out of Boston, and there's a multifamily building in all directions going up, the math once you get out of those core areas is still pretty challenging. One common thing that we heard back, and basically 90% of the stakeholder discussions, was the need locally and the discussions that have been happening through the 04 housing study and the 2013 housing study about the desire for market rate housing. So we were looking through the lens of that and looking at this as a market rate housing, some affordability, but not a subsidized income restricted majority multifamily building. And just some comments on the other aspects, again, from the development perspective, in looking at the large volume historic buildings, a full sort of gut rehab, full adaptive use, as Jimmy mentioned, into multifamily, into studios, something like that, it's just a very difficult step, because we know by looking at these buildings and comparing it to other projects, this is a very high cost. And again, that math becomes a real problem. So it's how do you make that building active and reuse it without that tremendous step of upfront investment. Another factor from the economic perspective, because the buildings are on the historic register, there's a possibility of using some financing tools, like federal historic tax credits, that can help offset some of those costs. But in looking at it, doing some sort of back of the envelope economics, it doesn't quite get you far enough to make that really a good, viable option from where we sit today.
So to put it in Goldilocks terms, we think this density is too high. Moving on to option B, we looked at the other end of the spectrum, which is looking at a series of smaller single-family buildings, maybe duplexes or single cottages on the site, as the residential component. The rest of the site is as it was in the previous scheme. And again, there's something to be said about this scale. There's a lot of market for that, generally, in terms of smaller single-family residences. The challenge here is that that's mostly what Wareham already has to offer. It's not as if Wareham needs more single-family housing. And in doing this layout, we were only coming up with about 12 or so units, so it didn't really feel like it was the highest and best use of the site. And I would also say that trying to imagine putting this together as a quaint little community immediately adjacent to all the activity and use that we wanted to have up here didn't necessarily fit like a good fit either. So again, we wanted to explore this option, but we're not sure if this is really the right fit either.
In the same vein, the concern was about the marketability of the single-family homes with hopefully a very active site, and the site that will probably be in transition for a few years. So it's the two-prong approach of the marketability might be difficult. The math might also be a little bit challenging, but then, you know, at the end of the day, is it the result that folks are looking for? And from what we heard, it wasn't exactly fitting the bill.
So again, Goldilocks would suggest this density is too low. So moving on to option C, this was meant to be sort of the middle ground option, which is to say, instead of doing one large multifamily building or a series of smaller single family buildings, there's actually an approach you can take where you do a series of smaller multifamily buildings. In this case, these would be smaller 12 unit buildings that can be arranged through the site and the area that's available for development. What we liked about this approach is it can be done incrementally. You could build one at a time. The scale of these also feels much more in keeping with the other buildings that are in the area, so it would feel like it belongs in this context. And they feel like they're sort of contributing to that campus feel that we're suggesting is out there today. These buildings would also allow you to carve out sort of a little bit of space along the edge that could be thought of as more of sort of a residential space, so the folks that live there would have a little place to go out and be without necessarily being in an area that's going to be more likely used by a much larger segment of the community. And again, we could get this to work from a parking perspective and everything else. So in this case, what we're showing is 3 12-unit buildings, so that's 36 units. So again, almost back to the scale of development the one single large building would provide, but broken up in a way that feels much more compatible with the site.
Yeah, it's that scalability. So the ability to limit that upfront risk, you're not taking a huge step at first, but someone has a more approachable way to get in. Maybe we're talking about the $2 to $3 million investment total for one of those 12-unit buildings. We've contemplated this as most likely rental apartments, but it allows you to sort of adapt and change as the rest of the site changes, as the market adapts, as the place becomes a place that people want to be. So this was what we thought was a very implementable plan in terms of the new construction.
Fully locked. She thinks this gets in, it's just ready. That said, we did hear a lot of people suggesting the notion of reusing the metal buildings, so we did feel like it was important to talk about that, to look at that, and try to consider that as an option. So that's what we showed here, option B, keeping the metal building. The advantage here, again, it's an existing structure, right? There's no upfront cost in terms of building a new building. It might need some work depending on what sort of uses you might be proposing in there. But certainly it's available. It's available today. It's available tomorrow. You can start utilizing it right away. The challenges, though, are that, one, it's not providing the residential balance that we were hoping to get. Two, it's not the most attractive of buildings, and it's a very large building, so it's there, but it's not really contributing in any meaningful way to the real character of the rest of the site. And just because it's there doesn't mean you would ever do that if it wasn't there. But again, we thought it was important to look at it and to consider it. And realistically, in the short term, it will continue to be there. Whatever we propose isn't going to happen overnight. And so, in effect, you'll see when we show the vision plan as the next stage, we think there's some legitimacy to considering this your short-term option and then really thinking of transitioning to a longer-term option. But again, this was another option we wanted to talk about and think about.
Yeah, just to add a couple points to that. In terms of generating the activity and creating that place where investment can be enticed to come in, that metal building is as flexible as it gets. It's a clear span building, it's wide open. The thought of reusing it for artist studios, there's several models around the country, even within the region, that can be looked at. Becomes a programmatic thing. It starts to generate activity, provide a service for those who really need it, and if the demand is there, we see that this could actually generate some revenue and start to make some payments back to the town. And if you think about people, again, in the report, we'll speak to some models to look at, but if you think about place where artists may pay a couple $100 a month to have a small space. We're not talking about anything that's really intensive fit out, but a place of a couple hundred square feet where they can do whatever they're doing, a maker space. You can see that there's a revenue generating model there. Takes some management, takes some operational thought, takes some programming. The building didn't look out. But again, looking at other models, there's a way that suddenly can create some income that starts to pay off or pay back and offset some of the costs that are burdened now, while also generating activity, really getting some activity going out there and making other things happen.
So Goldblocks is kind of okay with this option too. There's a short-term solution for creating value to help offset some of those long-term costs. And another thing we wanted to show is that, again, thinking of this thing really not as what the end product would be, but as an evolution, there would be several increments. We also did want to point out that technically there's also the option of really thinking about maybe the first of one of those multifamily buildings can go into the one empty portion of the site while that metal building is still online. So maybe this is something to think about in terms of the increment of how this would come online. We also have the metal building, I think we kind of mentioned it, but seeing that as an opportunity to test some of the ideas that we're thinking about up here, like artist studios or hosting certain events out there or musical performances. Who's to say you couldn't try those out in that building? Again, it's not maybe as wonderful an atmosphere as you might wish for, but it could certainly serve a role and maybe allow you to test some of those ideas before you've gone through all of the expense of renovating some of these buildings or as you're going through the expense of renovating some of those buildings. And I did have to quickly point out, even though I've been using Goldilocks as the reference, it's actually the three bears that we've been using. So in terms of the proposed vision plan, taking all those things into account and the discussions that we had in consideration, again, I'm going to show you both a short-term and a long-term vision. And again, these will look familiar. These are similar to the preliminary concepts, but they're in much more detail, and we'll try to go through those. In the short term, what we've determined is that it makes sense to retain all of the existing buildings that are out there and utilize them to the best of your ability in your current condition, but certainly start making the improvements so that you can continue using them for higher and greater uses. Second is to retain the central parking area, continue utilizing that for parking. That makes all the sense in the world. But really thinking of this little offshoot of that parking lot as this yard area, utilize it and improve it. So thinking of that as being somewhere where you could host a farmer's market, or that's somewhere where you could host an outdoor concert, or that's somewhere where you could host any number of other little events. What's really neat is the existing historic buildings really make that space feel almost like a room, albeit an outdoor room, but you're contained and you have a wonderful charm and character of the existing factory buildings all around you. And over time that could be improved, maybe instead of putting down fresh asphalt, you're able to use some sort of stamped concrete so it starts to feel like it's different from the parking area. And in a similar light, really take advantage of the couple of green spaces that are out on the water's edge. In most cases, these things are currently still showing their previous industrial use, but if you could clean some of them up or make some space available, the kayak launch is already here, so this one's already sort of served its purpose. This little peninsula between the fish ladder and the sluice way is a nice lawn that you can walk down in that space. It's actually kind of a charming spot. But certainly these two areas are a little bit rough right now, and so in so much as those can be improved upon, maybe put out some picnic tables so folks can kind of use those areas, even in their current condition, they're actually really charming and wonderful places to be. Next is build that dock at the launch site. Again, this probably shouldn't be thought of as short term, but maybe medium term. Again, there needs to be funding sources to do such a thing, but we would say, go for it. We're working with the town of Dover, or the city of Dover up in New Hampshire, similar process, a waterfront site the city owns that could do an RFP to bring in private developers, but they were able to secure a lot of state funds to actually build a dock out on the water's edge. So the city itself has a very small outlay compared to the grant that they were able to get. So they're moving forward with a dock, and that's a great way of bringing people down, getting additional use. Again, the kayaks could be coming in and out of here all day long, not just at high tide, and certainly is sort of a draw for folks to come out and the site. Next is to work on creating the pedestrian connections that aren't there currently. So currently the south side of Elm Street, there are no sidewalks, and we think it makes sense to think about doing improvements along that southern edge, putting sidewalks along here. The sidewalks on Main Street kind of come around the corner and end, should go ahead and make the rest of that connection. Folks that live over here have a good means of coming through. There are technically sidewalks on the northern side, they're also in pretty rough shape, so probably improve those at the same time. But in a similar light, we think it makes sense to imagine that there could be a pedestrian connection that really brings you down along the entirety of the water's edge. There's an existing bridge here, but we could imagine putting maybe a small pedestrian bridge there. Now you can start to connect all those dots along the water's edge. And taking that a step further, imagine that there could be a trail that actually takes you along the water's edge all the way down to Merchant's Way, all the way down into the Main Street area. There are plans to try to do a nice boardwalk and other things at the water's end in the Merchant's Way area. This would be a way of connecting those dots. Now you've got a means other than Main Street of coming back and forth between the two. It'd be an awesome place to ride your bike, go for a hike, those sorts of things. And then lastly, in the short term, understanding that the dam is closed for particular traffic, you can still utilize it for what it is today. There's some picnic tables out there, there's some planters out there. Really think of that as another space that can be utilized and programmed until the repairs are made. So this is what that looks like. We'll zoom in a little bit closer to that so I can talk you through all the specific points. But first, from the sort of proposed uses. So we've taken all of the input we've been getting from you folks as a way of sort of really refining the more general thought about cultural, retail, much more specific program suggestions. Again, these are just recommendations. It's worth noting that this could go any number of ways as it truly evolves over the next couple of years. So we might, like I said, suggest a space should be an event space, but maybe it ends up wanting to be a museum, and there's a third-party nonprofit that comes on board that's able to manage and host to do that. There's no reason we couldn't do that, but still support the larger goal and mission and vision that we're proposing here. So, first off, in the historic office in the front portion, that's the two-story actual portion from 1848, we would suggest that makes a lot of sense as a sort of museum and welcome center, so that if there is someone that they're going to have some exhibits out about the history of the site, about how it was used as for the nail manufacturing, whatever else wants to be discussed, utilizing that little building that has a front door address on Elm Street, folks would be able to intuitively find that. And in fact, there could be some parking immediately adjacent to it, allow folks to come in. Really think of that as the first stop for someone who's coming to the site for the very first time, to understand what's going on. And again, that could be a short-term thing while everything else is still happening. There'd still be somewhere for the public to come, interact, and appreciate the site, and build up support for the redevelopment of the site. And the one-story addition off the back of it, we thought maybe that makes sense as being some sort of office use. Certainly, if we imagine, depending on how this all plays out, if this mostly ends up being owned and managed by a private entity, we might imagine that they would actually need property management on site. And this would be a good place to put it, if for no other reason than that might allow the museum to be open more hours, because their staff could be, you know, sitting at their desk and just keeping an eye on people coming and going. Otherwise, the museum is probably more likely restricted to sort of weekend hours when volunteers can be there. But certainly, even if it's not property management or they only need a limited portion, there's nothing to say that that couldn't also operate pretty well, actually, as a local realtor's office or an accountant's office or some other kind of office use. Again, because it has a presence on Elm Street and address, intuitive parking solutions. So again, it can kind of be its own independent thing. We're talking about a pretty small number of areas. So again, that could go in a number of ways. But again, that's what we would promote thinking about for the historic office building. In the factory building itself, in the big main space, again, we've been talking about that as an event space. And really, we're thinking of that more along the lines of being a possible music venue or hosting exhibitions. There's the antique car show is going to be here July 4th as part of the larger antique fair. You know, who's to say that when that space is fixed up, you could pull some of the cars actually in there and do like an indoor exhibit or artwork or other things could go on in there. Maybe the high school science fair, you know, ends up getting located here instead of at the school. So really thinking of that, again, as being left open and appreciable but in its glory that's out there now with all the great old gears and everything else in place.
Can you say how big that space is?
Very large, but I don't remember what the square footage is.
About 19,000.
Is that for the whole building or just that main volume?
The whole building is up.
Okay. So that building is not only that main space, but these couple of what we'll call L's, but I'm sure that, you know, 15 or 16 of that 19 is probably the space that's inside there. Next, the Western L, the little Western addition, that's currently where the blacksmith shop resides. And we think, again, based on a good suggestion from the last public meeting, that should be left as the blacksmith shop. Again, it might only get limited use for, you know, exhibits during, you know, big craft show or something that might be out here. But it makes sense to preserve that. It's a nice way of preserving some of the history of the site, letting someone come out and demonstration, showing what sort of things used to happen on the site. So again, preserve the blacksmith shop and make it available when it makes sense to. The Southern L, similar light, the existing tool shop that kind of sits in this corner of here, we should preserve the tool shop. Again, it could be a similar scenario where folks can use it for demonstrations. It could be open at other times and that makes sense. But again, it's one of those places to sort of preserve some of the vestiges of the uses that had been out here previously so that history is still appreciable. But for the balance of that Southern L, we would propose that's really the best site for a microbrewery or a restaurant. The thinking here is that kind of use would be very sympathetic and work well if you're thinking of there being events or music venue, the fact that there's a place that you can go get some food, you can go get a drink, that might allow us to build a few restrooms inside the building. So again, depending on what the use is, there's restrooms available. And if you think of it as a microbrewery, in my mind, it would be nice, even if that's not quite enough space for them to do all their operations, if they had to put their brewery tanks out in the main volume of the factory space, I think that would actually work pretty well. It wouldn't really detract from the character or the vibe of the factory space.
So how many parking spots do you envision being available here?
For the overall site?
Yes.
Go back and see where our numbers ended up. Can we go back? If I can do that quickly, so we get something. So we were at the main area, we were about 100 parking spaces total. 100 spaces for the whole site.
And is there any overflow anywhere nearby that it seems, especially if there's residential, that would get quite a bit of it?
Yeah, I mean, the theory was that there was enough here that you would have all the parking you need for the residential and still have plenty for the other uses. I think one of the thoughts here, too, is understanding that some of these uses might not all happen at the exact same time. So in other words, you're coming out renting a kayak at the same time that there's a concert, for instance. You know, that some of those spaces could be shared, if you will. They're flexible and they're open for those different things. But it is something you would need to manage. But I think there also, that the town probably does have overflow areas and certainly a lot of open space over here, some of these other underutilized parking areas that if you're hosting a big event here, there might be the ability to use some of those other spaces for overflow parking. So we think there are creative solutions to parking instead of letting the parking be the driver per se. But I do think when we did our math, we felt like it was reasonable. We were sort of going crazy and saying, hey, there's four parking spaces out here, sort of a thing. So. And then lastly, in the main factory building, that Eastern L, we were thinking that could actually be a really cool spot to think of their long-term meeting some artist studios or maker spaces out there. We mentioned that as potential short-term use here, and again, imagine that we've tested that out, and there are a few artists that do want to take residence up here and utilize this space. Thinking of improving that back corner of the factory building for that use, we thought would be really cool. Again, it would give that sort of industrial vibe that the factory building has could sort of spill over into that space. Those folks that might be in an arrangement where they could actually utilize the blacksmith shop and the tool shop, so maybe they're using those things when they're being used for demonstrations. And that the improvements that we're proposing up here, there'd be a way of accessing that building so that folks could make their way back to their studios. So if those artists have, you know, certain open hours where folks can come and actually buy their goods and things along those lines, we think that could actually work and be a viable use in that corner of the factory building. And the freight building, again, that main space that's at the southern end, again, an event space, but again, a different kind of set of events. Great for weddings, great for parties, corporate events. For those of you who haven't been in there, it's beautiful, big, huge timber trusses up above. When you open the barn doors at the southern end, you get views all the way down to Merchant's Way, which are really cool. And you really do feel like you're right on the water inside of that building. So again, I think the scale and character of that as an event space is very different than the scale and character of that. And so they can be, I think, both used to good uses. And then thinking of the northern L of that building, as potentially being retrofit to be a restaurant or cafe. And in the same way that we thought this restaurant microbrewery would have a nice sympathetic use with the event space here, and then you can imagine that that restaurant maybe does the catering for the weddings that are there, or it's an opportunity to have a bathroom too inside the building, or a place to get a drink during whatever other events might occur there. And again, thinking of these being some of the uses right on the centralized space, that, you know, that cafe could have outdoor seating either in the yard, maybe also in this sort of lawn area. And so they're in the right places to be able to spill out and utilize the spaces that are outside. Next is the packaging building. Again, long-term, we still think that having some sort of power sports component here is gonna make a lot of sense. So this building is about the right size based on our discussions with Nemaska Kayak for what they would imagine needing out here. So it's a realistic size space. Still puts them in close proximity to the boat launch today and maybe the dock in the future. Gives them the ability to lay some of their boats out maybe in the yard so you can see either what's for sale or what's for rent. Certainly is adjacent to parking, so if you do go there and buy a kayak, they can pop right on top of your car for you. So again, we think that's a sympathetic use that really takes good advantage of the specific site context and the amenities that are out here. And will help bring people to the site. You know, folks are gonna come here to rent a kayak and maybe they stick around and have a sandwich and realize there's an exhibit going on in the main factory building, and then if they stick around for another half hour, they can get a tour of the old historic facility. So, and the idea here is creating these uses that can help support and feed one another. And then the small pickling building here, this is one that we sort of least defined. We've called it what we refer to as a white box space, which is just to say it's cleaned up, fixed up, made ready for any number of uses. So maybe somebody in the summer months rents it out and sells flowers or sells ice cream from there. maybe other times of year, a local artist co-op could come in and use it as a gallery space and take turns trying to sell art out of that space. It's also, I think, the most contaminated building, so it's the building that has sort of the most uncertain future in terms of whether or not it's going to make sense to really spruce it up to be able to use it to sell flowers, but again, it certainly contributes to the larger campus feel. So our hope is that it can be retained, creative solutions can be found there. We are suggesting removing, there's a little cinder block addition off the back of it that doesn't need to be there, that should come down. But again, you can see the idea is to create this little bit of a critical mass of retail that's supportive of one another, and that really take full advantage of the sort of public spaces that are being created in that spot in the plan. The metal building, again, keeping it, maybe using it as art studios, maker spaces, use it for indoor markets or shows, storage, and whatever creative uses we can put into that building. Again, it's a very large building, probably be all of the above and still operate in that sense. But again, we're thinking of this as the short-term vision is imagining just keeping it and utilizing it to the best of our abilities. And quickly, lastly, the restroom building that's out there, again, maintaining that as a restroom building, there is a larger event like a car show or a farmer's market. Those restrooms might be needed on a day-to-day basis, when it's really just sort of these things in operation. It probably doesn't need to be opened up. But again, it exists and it can really help support larger site. And then last but not least, the little freight shed, a little building that's just down at the end of the yard. Again, we just suggested maybe that's simply storage, that there's going to be needs out here, places to put tables, chairs, etc. And it's not a very large building, but retain it and keep it on site. It's contributing to the character of the place for sure. And then dialing into the outdoor spaces themselves, I'll try to go through these relatively quickly. Here's a proposed path that would connect you down the Merchant's Way, making its way into the area. Proposed dock, maybe a pavilion out on the end. That would be a nice draw to get people to walk out to the end of the dock. It would also be something you'd be able to see from Merchant's Way and maybe realize, oh, there's something else going on further up the river we should go check out. But also afford views back up to the sluice way and all the way down. So it'd just be a neat spot to be out there in the middle of the river there. Potentially doing a patio area where there's currently just a little bit of grass and tapering off to the boat launch. Would provide a nice lookout spot for folks coming down here at the end of the yard. Also, again, an outdoor space connected to the freight building of that space, space to spill out. The yard itself, we've been talking about, again, showing the ability to put cafe tables. Maybe there's some farmers market stands. Maybe there's food trucks on, you know, the really busiest days out here. Again, that can serve to connect all of these uses together. And also, in the event of a large event where we don't need it for those uses, you know, there's another 20 parking spaces that still exist there. So maybe if there's a wedding on a Sunday and nothing else is happening out there, you can actually allow folks to park out there. And almost more importantly, what it really does is it provides emergency access. Fire trucks and ambulances will really want to be able to get back into that portion of the site. So again, a creative way of letting them get back there, but really thinking of it being used as more of a public space most of the time. The green area out on the water's edge, and then thinking of that maybe being cleaned up and converted into a lawn, might have some benches, might have some picnic tables, again, somewhere you can come out. And maybe somebody mentioned the notion of having outdoor classrooms out here. It'd be great to have a field trip come out here so the kids could gather and you can talk about the history before you walk it through. So again, a really wonderful space right on the river. Opening this up as the access to that eastern L, and whatever uses might go in there. Taking advantage of the existing bridge that comes over here for pedestrian access. And then at the lower end of that peninsula that sticks out there, maybe there's a little lookout point there as well, a new little pedestrian bridge, so again, folks can really make their way down along the water's edge all the way through the site. And again, as I mentioned earlier, just while that dam needs to be closed, might as well capitalize on being able to use it short-term. Maybe that's where you put your farmer's markets, so that somebody on the highway can actually see the farmer's market. You're not counting on them having gotten a flyer that tells them to come all the way down to here to find it. Maybe in the short term, while it's getting established, it's out in a very visible location so that folks are aware that that activity is beginning to happen. You mentioned the proposed sidewalk along the southern edge of Elm Street. Again, I mentioned a little bit of parking that could be right on the street. So again, someone who's never been there before has a quick and easy, intuitive place to find a place to park. Primary site access is exactly where it's been. And even though we're showing the use of this parking area, we're suggesting that it be formalized, which is to say right now it's just a big slab of pavement. You could put in place, certainly paint stripes, so they could be efficiently used for parking. But maybe there's also some landscape islands that can host some trees to provide a little shade and soften up that space a little bit. Certainly those are the areas that might allow us to do some of the stormwater management we need out there. So again, some of these things will be layered in over time, but this is what we would like to get to in the short term, as short a term as possible. And quickly transition into the long term. The bulk of the site stays the same. The real change is one, adding residential units in this other corner of the site, and two, imagining that this does get repaired to the point that it can allow vehicular traffic to be back on Elm Street, coming all the way through back to Cranberry Highway. We think it'll be important to try and imagine folks can access the site from either end, coming off of Cranberry Highway from either end, for the long-term viability and success of what we're proposing here. So this is what that looks like with the residential added. Again, this was that notion of those three 12-unit buildings along this edge as the sort of what we think being the most sensitive way of adding residential new construction into this site. And then looking at those more specifically, some of you may have noticed this building was oriented the other way previously because we were thinking in terms of, we think of buildings and streets as the buildings providing the walls of the street. And currently without anything here, there's actually a fairly large gap you have to get by before you get down here. And reintroducing a building we thought was a nice way to imagine if someone walking would have that street wall that next thing you see. So our initial impulse was to put the building long ways. But as we thought about it, we realized that by turning it sort of the short face is facing Elm Street, you begin to see it's much more sympathetic in terms of the scale of what it presents to the street as the existing buildings that are out there. We have a rendering, and we'll show that in a little more detail in a moment. Reconfiguring this parking area to get that little bit more parking you need for the residential uses. Again, I mentioned the notion of there being some kind of a residential green space that's created out there. Maybe one end of that has a little residential gazebo or a fire pit or some kind of amenity that's back there. And some other folks also made comments that once all these improvements are made, maybe there's also additional trails that go back through the natural areas that you can maybe have educational signage about wetlands and how wetlands work, et cetera. Is there anything you wanted to add to this before?
Just a comment on the transition from short to long term. One of the topics that we discussed in looking at the conversion of one to the next is that idea of the highest and best use from a real estate perspective. Establishing all the activity and the improvements and starting to create that place where people want to be, and then as that it is successful and established, you start to be able to build upon that by bringing in the multifamily and phasing out the temporary metal building. And perhaps that allows the artists, the makers that are there to start to populate into some other areas or as a feeder program in the Main Street, but really as a way to sort of step through and evolve as these improvements are happening.
And lastly, we have a couple of views to show what that proposed vision plan would look like. So here you are in a hot air balloon, floating somewhere probably over Central Park. This is Elm Street coming through the main factory building here. So this is showing what those sort of three smaller multifamily buildings might look like. Again, here this first one, showing a short face to the road. This could really be detailed and made to look a lot like it's just a grand house that would have been here all along. You can see the scale of this is very much in keeping with the scale of the Fearing Tavern, which is directly across the street. And so again, a way of introducing new construction that feels like it could have been there all along. And introducing those buildings incrementally as they work their way back to the site, again, it allows them to carve out maybe a little bit of space for the residents just along the edge. They can wave to the trash train as it goes by. The historic office building here, again, this allowing it to be the sort of first point of access as you come in, you can park, you can come into the Welcome Center if you've not been there before, and see what's going on. This separate office building could have its own entry and access off of here. And the lights coming down into the main parking area, you can see it with some trees added, it really softens it up, breaks it up a little bit. So that's what it would look like potentially from this end. And then if you come down now to the other end, so now we're kind of over the fish ladder and the sluiceway, this being the main factory building here. This view was really meant to try to show you that sequence of spaces along the river's edge. So the current peninsula that kind of comes out, we're showing this notion that there's a little lookout point and there's the opportunity for a little public art down at that point. A new pedestrian bridge that would connect you over. The access now to this renovated corner of the building here. Again, the existing bridge feeds you over. And you can see that lawn area and it has benches, that has picnic tables. Little restaurant cafe operating here, so come grab a sandwich, come sit on the water's edge and have your sandwich. You can see the yard here being utilized for a number of different things, food trucks, cafe tables, kayaks. Again, that could be farmer's market, that could be closed down for one event, or it could have multiple small things happening all at the same time. Making your way all the way down, this is that little patio out in the corner of the building, the new dock with a million folks paddling by here. And there's that trail that would take you all the way down, potentially into Merchant's Way. So again, someone could come and really enjoy the experience of being on the river's edge, but also be redirected back into the activity and the businesses that are trying to be supported by the folks coming up to that area. And then again, you can see those incremental smaller residential buildings, again, on the opposite side of the site, again, providing that 24-hour use here. And again, the scale that we think is reasonable, fitting in with this campus of smaller buildings otherwise. So I apologize that went as long as it did. But again, we wanted to now open this up to you all for discussion, for your thoughts, feedback, questions. I did want to just quickly point out, we had the coordinator's website. It sounds like some folks are having an issue utilizing it. If that is the case, please let us know. Get a hold of Ken, or certainly I can leave business cards for folks that have been having problems with that. But we've had a lot of use of it, so it seems to be working for some folks, which is good. That's the website right there, or if you Google search Tremont Nail Factory, it's actually like one of the top seven or eight results that come up, so you'll be able to find it that way as well. So what do you think? But that metal building might be the way of testing those things and understanding, you know, we suggested making this available as artist studios. So,
but there are two different kinds of building fields. One, I'm going to, for example, the large barn, you know, the factory itself, it is kind of already performance spacey, but intimate performance space versus a metal building could be considered performance space as well as. Stalled off with food menus, artist spaces, and all those things, as well as being able to handle things like a talk show, a classic art show, and the entire show fit in that building, for example. In a rainy day, the entire farmer's market fit in that building, etc. I mean, a lot of European cities and even towns that are much more sunnier than where it tends to be this year, not exclusive. But like down in Florida, etc., there are very large areas where people of a town can gather and have a good time. Because of the weather, we can't really do that. I mean, it rains, a lot of events just get canceled. A place like that would be able to handle tons of what we do here.
Yeah.
You know, we're not just in the same section of town, but,
sure.
But you can always do. You know, if it's raining or snowing or something, it's raining, that's a great place to have stuff. I mean, it's giant and smooth, and, you know, and when it's not raining, it's a great income maker as well.
So I think that's where our hope is, that when this building is fixed up, it also provides that very large indoor kind of event space, gathering space. I would say if the metal building becomes the most successful square footage in all of Wareham, of course you should probably just keep it. Our intuition is that it's only going to be able to be utilized so far before it doesn't make sense. You know, I mean, some amount of it may be left empty all the time. You know, I think when Eric was doing his math, he was suggesting it was like 45 artist studios. We don't even know if there's 45 artists looking for studios in all of the Cape. But I think if it was a wildly successful use, you could either say, forget even worrying about replacing it, this thing is doing so great, we might as well keep it. Or how much of those sort of things could be translated to other portions of the site as they come online, as they need a time frame to prepare? Or, I thought it was actually a very interesting comment someone made, why not reutilize that building in a different location? Maybe there's another parcel where you could, you know, unscrew the 100 bolts that are holding that thing together, reconstruct it on another site, or some of those things could continue to occur. And that would still allow you to get the residential use here, which we think, again, is that, that sort of third leg of the stool of giving this place that sort of 24-hour and mix of uses that really needs to go off the activities. But I don't think I have
a definitive answer. We can look about it, but another thing you mentioned is the look of it. It's that building. You can kind of glue stuff on the other side and make it look like, you know, a much more comfortable feel than the design. I guess something we needed. It used to be a yellow building. If you're aware of that. But anyway, the point is that it just seems to me that there's a good possibility of probably being a pretty successful space on its own. Because it's yes, it is similar to the nail factory itself, but it's not the same thing. It's different, and it has different feel and different things that it invites different kinds of activities in that. But I understand, if it doesn't, then, clearly, I know Derek wants, who doesn't want to try to, reclaim as much property as possible, which is tax-paying property, as opposed to just giving away culture. I understand that, but I just think that there's a good possibility that a building like that can be utilized by lots of other things that won't be quite as comfortable inside that building. Okay, that's my questions.
Okay. Speaking of artists, can I add in for a moment?
Sure.
Kirk Whipple with Cranberry Coast Concerts. I don't know how many of you know who we are, but we've been operating a concert series for the last 12 years in town. And I did bring extra copies of the notes for everyone, if you like these. But 25 years ago to this minute, I was on the stage performing an original two-piano concerto with my wife at our wedding. And the reason why I say that is because this inspired us to cancel our anniversary plans. And secondly, because we see that we've been doing what we've been doing for decades, and this is a huge opportunity, we think, to create a very culturally vital space. Something like this, I think that we're fortunate to hook up with Peter, and he took us through the site with our theatrical director, Mike Dewar, and we came up, and I'm not going to run through all of this, but I have some of these for everybody, our thoughts on the matters. And the big things that came up is that this needs to become a destination with its own identity. And then there's a lot of things that could happen here. I mean, if you have concerts and, for example, these residential spaces that you're talking about, if they're bed and breakfast or places where artist companies come in and out, you're bringing tourists in and out, you can bring conventions in and out, and all those people are going off into the world telling people about this wonderful, exciting space. And I mean, when we started the concert series here, and we did a little bit of vision questing around the area, we saw a long-term possibility, and that's why we put our festival here for the last 12 years. And right now we're doing mostly small things at Eastern Bank, using the Bay, in Attleboro, but we would love to be here when it's ready. And a couple of the quick things too, we came up with a good marketing ploy for this. I don't know why it's taking this long for Wareham to say, look, you don't have to go over the bridge, you don't have to fight traffic to get over there for great culture. Put up signs on 195, 495 to lead people here, drawing those tourist dollars here. And one of the things that we do frequently in South Florida, we are the conservatory, we write grants all the time, working with other organizations to draw in tourist bucks. And it can make a huge difference in this area year round, not just
there are many organizations and individuals that are trying to bring Wareham and onto the same destination.
Exactly.
Getting the bus to come to Wareham and onto what I have been referring to as Greater Wareham.
Yeah, exactly.
But there's tons of us trying to make that happen.
And I was going to say too, you've got
not in a nice fashion.
Yeah.
It's feeling warm.
Well, let's organize it. And by the way, you've got WCTV, who's silently taping behind the scenes over there. They're right around the corner. and we're doing some video productions with them. We've been doing it for years. You've got a natural thing here where you have a video talent production, so it's really quite extraordinary right in your backyard that can produce events. And I mean, this could be, you know, the new Wolf Trap, Tanglewood. Make people say, Tangle, what Red Wareham today? So, I, as a performing and presenting artist, I want to say I think that the vision should be huge for this space. And including your big building right there, our theatrical director wanted to say, you've got a fly space in there for theatrical productions that you don't have anywhere else in the region. So there's a lot of things that call us anytime about.
No, I think having this site available as maybe a ground zero for all those organizations to come around and figure out how best to utilize these spaces. I don't know if it's available in Wareham right now for hosting these kinds of events and things. It doesn't sound like maybe the marketing option. So all of those resources, all those people working hard together, I think they'll help. If the money's not there, at least the people are there that are trying to bring the money there.
Oh, and one other idea too. There's, for example, there's a working with nonprofits such as ours. There's a thing called the Our Town Grants that everybody needs to look into. If the current administration doesn't kill the National Endowment for the Arts, there's something that's been happening over the years where towns apply with, and I mean, we talked to South Pino when he was involved in this. We're talking about possibly applying for this. You need a town entity plus a nonprofit arts entity, and the grants start at $25,000 and go up to $250,000. For a single 1 or 2 year project to encourage arts organizations and towns to work together to create cultural viable spaces.
But they aren't looking for very specific stuff, they're looking for creative placement. And that is what's going on here, but it has to happen in the cultural district. They're not gonna finance it without the cultural district.
Right.
Which we have two cultural districts right now that are already the applications are started, but they're not complete. Someone earlier about that. We have those applications have already begun. We're two years into it. The selectmen had made the pronouncement of the cultural districts 2 years ago, two springs ago. So
yeah. So I'll
utilize that. Needs to be tied together and organized.
Yeah, I was just to say quickly, just to segue, what I didn't mention earlier with the other projects we've done with mass development and so on and so forth, that one of the real advantages of going through these kinds of exercises, coming up with a vision that has public support, is when you're going after for those kinds of grants, being able to sort of tack this on the end of your application shows that there's a big picture idea here. There's something that's trying to be made. It's not just, you know, somebody's whim idea. There's actually something really, you know, legitimate and fruitful that could happen. So it's very helpful for looking after grants of various types. So, yes, sir.
The retail space that we talked about tonight is consistent. Were any other options for those outbuildings considered at all, given the abundance, if you will, of available retail space we have right now? I struggle mightily with how that could be viable.
Yeah, I think that's when we made the comment of being complementary but not competitive with Merchants Way. I think Merchants Way has plenty of sort of retail space available if you wanted to open up any number of sort of other types of retail spaces. I think the reason we kind of, and a lot of people were suggesting it, but the notion of the restaurant, a waterfront restaurant, a microbrewery, those are kind of things that want to be in a sort of special place, a different kind of a place, and also serve as draws. Joel and I were here talking about microbreweries, how when you hear about a really cool one, that's, even if it's 45 minutes away, people will drive there to check it out and see what's going on. So I think that's why we thought those were the kind of retail uses that made sense here, instead of thinking of it as a t-shirt shop or as a, you know, whatever else there might be. And certainly the Cabo Sports, again, makes a lot of sense because of the very specific, the launch is there, the dock might be there, it's got the water access, so.
You know, t-shirt shops aren't gonna fly down that. T-shirt shops fly with glass bowl and cracks, you know, clay and rebuilding things. That's gonna fly here. That kind of stuff, people that do that kind of stuff can't afford downtown. Mm-hmm. I mean, downtown is very expensive. It's a very expensive, footprint. This that hasn't got that kind of history.
If I can just reinforce the point, too. You know, when we're saying retail, there's no contemplation of a Dunkin' Donuts or a CVS or something going into these spots. Right. It's not a retail location. the retail components are really, just as every other programmatic piece listed, is really reinforced by the other ones. They all kind of have, again, using the term again, evolve together. And if you create that place where artists want to be, and there's events and all, that's, I think, when you start to have that gallery, that makerspace that starts to creep into being more retail, because it allows people to meet buyers and to have traffic there. But just as a standalone, you don't expect that CVS is going to take that building and move in first thing.
So, follow up on that. The buildings that are targeted right now for retail, not the big ones, but they are all in that space that you identified earlier as not being torn down and rebuilt. It's only being renovated.
Correct.
It's only being renovated to a level of a cap of 50% of the current rate value.
At each given increment, that's correct.
At
any given increment. In other words, if it's like the case I was reading earlier, imagine one of those buildings is worth $10,000. You could do $5,000 worth of improvements on that. Call that as your first phase. Once that's complete, now let's say your building is worth $15,000. You can do your next phase of improvements, $7,500. Now your building is worth $2,250, $11,000. So it snowballs slowly, but the point was that you couldn't just say, I'm going to make this a restaurant. I've got $200,000 in my pocket, so I'm going to take the $10,000 building. You can't do it overnight. And we're looking into whether or not there might be the ability to have some kind of exception there, but the regulation as it's written suggests there's a limit to that.
Do you know the appraised value of the building right now?
Do you know the appraised value of this
building? I don't have any appraised value on the top of my head, but there is a process in Massachusetts Board of Building Regulations and Standards where you can request waivers of the FEMA regulations. And I wouldn't guarantee that they would grant it, but I will say that they are much more friendly to municipalities asking for such things than they are for private entities.
So you think it's workable if we follow the way of process?
I believe so, yes.
That's where second, like, depending on which way that conversation goes, we think you can get there eventually, you just might have to do it incrementally. You might have to be patient.
I understand that.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
We will be hosting, in addition to our 41st annual antique and craft fair this year, we'll be hosting a car show down on the Tremont Mail property. Paul Gerard, who's the owner of the room, is coordinating that for us, and we're very grateful for that opportunity. So just a heads up, folks, that come down and visit the car show this summer. The other thing is that we host over 200 minor forest elementary school children on field trips, fourth graders. Tomorrow being one of the 2 days that we have those 200 children coming. And we would certainly welcome the opportunity to go down to the Tremont Mail Museum piece of it and include that in that educational process. That would be a wonderful and a tremendous boost to this community. We try to get the young people aware of the historic footprint that we have here in town, and that would be very welcome.
And I will say too, it's exciting that there's already some activity happening in the kayak center moving in there. The fact that the car show is going to be there, I think in so much as the town can get other uses and events and whatever we can get going to kind of build up that scheme of use, make people aware that these things are here if they aren't aware, if they've driven by on the street every day. You know, getting people aware of the site being there, getting some use out of the site, and that's how it starts to build some momentum.
I'll address a couple of those things at the end.
Oh, great.
Just get a couple more things in pipeline.
Excellent. Yes, ma'am.
So from a historic standpoint, what we're already kind of doing there, we have kind of a corridor going on within the historic district of the meeting house and the school, the little school, and the chapel, and the Barry Tavern. So I think that first building that you were talking about, making it kind of like a mansion type looking, somebody mentioned a B&B or residential, it would kind of jumpstart that whole thing. And if perhaps historic buildings in town could be, you know, that maybe they could be moved to that area, it would certainly help, I think, bring that history to that area that would be very historic.
Yeah, absolutely. And we tried to show what that looks like earlier. That really isn't, there's an empty parcel of land right there right now. So conceivably, if someone was ready to build a bed and breakfast tomorrow, and the town could figure it all out. There's nothing really preventing something like that happening in that one spot while everything else is still going on. Our intuition is that the rest of it needs to probably come a little bit further along before it's going to make sense to do something along those lines, but certainly if it's repurposing a historic building somewhere else in town on that site, or thinking of it as a bed and breakfast instead of a little multi-family building, those things, those all are reinforcing the same notions that we're going after. So the uses are really our thinking, but again, it could go any number of ways depending on what plays out. Yes, sir.
I love the idea of the kayak launch on there. I put it myself many times on there to join the ride. But sometimes at low tide, I've noticed what looks to be like an old fish weir. There's a post sticking up. It's probably about 30, 40 yards down. Is there any problem with the dock sticking out of that? Is that a historic site? Are you aware of that? Do you know anything
about that? I'm not aware of that. I don't know if that would be an issue or not. Certainly, the only other experience I have is what we've been doing in Dover, and certainly the area that we're putting in the new dock was a historic working waterfront. And so there are any number of regulations and things you need to go through and get the approvals and reviews and so on and so forth. But I can't imagine it'd be something that would necessarily prevent you from being able to do that there. And historically, I'm sure there were things there. I mean, that's, the freight building is on the water's edge because the supplies would come up the river and they all floated at that point there. So certainly there probably were docks or other things there historically that this might be anything in the way too. So. Yes, ma'am.
As someone who has gone to numerous destination points, day trips, and other trips throughout the country, one of the things that is absolutely essential to keep people in an area like that for any time at all, they are restroom facilities. The only restroom facilities that you mentioned were associated with two restaurants, and those are not going to happen quickly. So if you're going to want people to start using that space, there has to be some sort of public restroom facility.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. And there exists this small building that was the restrooms actually for the factory workers. I'm guessing it's probably not in full working order just at the moment. But I do think that you could probably imagine getting that in working order, and the idea was that that would be there and available for people that are using the site, certainly in bigger events. I don't know with the kayak center, I don't know if they're just assuming you're renting a kayak, that doesn't mean you've got a bathroom for you, maybe you've got a portal drone out there, I'm not sure, but it is an excellent point. I think especially as this thing comes online, if you really are thinking that there's a musical performance going on there, you're definitely going to need a number of restrooms beyond.
One of our points too is that there should be a restroom in every space that's being used.
Yeah, so certainly again, thinking about, you know, that's part of the reason thinking about there being a restaurant affiliated with the event space. Now it makes sense why there's a restaurant that's actually being used by the restaurant all the time and is available for limited times for our event spaces. But yeah, the number of restrooms, like, that's valid, like the kind of stuff that we would really need to think through as this thing evolves. Because in any given step, you might have to think about, well, that's not online yet, so we got to think about how we're going to like it here and so on and so forth. So, yes, sir.
I believe you're trying to preserve the historic site and the buildings. And if I understood your presentation tonight, you're talking about low-end housing, low-cost type of things going in the space building. If you use that end of the land in that type of building, and you are successful to get somebody to come down and actually look at Tremont Mail, and they decide that they need 200 spot parking places or more, aren't you sort of closing yourself out to that because you won't have that land to offer to preserving the historic sites?
First of all, I think with the housing, to answer that question first, we were talking about market rate housing, which is to say not subsidized, not low rent. I also don't think
you take that.
What's that?
I didn't indicate that. I just said the lower end. You said high-end housing was out because of the location. And then you said you were going to drop it down a couple of levels to get to a certain spot. All I'm saying to you, if you develop that land, which is vacant now, can be used for anything, before you actually do something with the Tremont Nail property, aren't you closing yourself out to that promotion?
I guess potentially, but the way we looked at it, and based on assuming that these things were up and running at their long-term highest and best use, we still thought that there was sufficient parking with the existing large parking lot that's out there. I don't think we imagined that there were any uses that would come here that would suddenly need twice as much parking as is out here. Or if there were individual items like if the antique fair becomes the one big event that happens here, you actually close this parking lot for the antique fair. In those types of scenarios, that's where we're saying you would have to probably think of a satellite lot kind of scenario, utilizing underutilized parcels in the local area. So I guess I don't foresee that there would ever be a need for whatever comes in here to suddenly need 200 spaces instead of 100 spaces, especially against if you can't tear down and build something new here. So it's not as if, you know, the Hilton can come in and say, we want to put a four-story hotel here and we need 150 spaces. The way the regulations are written, I think the way everybody in this room would come out to the town hall meeting and say, you're crazy. The historic buildings are going to be preserved, they're going to be reutilized. They can only stretch so far in terms of use. So I wouldn't be as concerned about that. And I would also suggest we see this as probably being the last piece of the puzzle to fall in place, that long-term sort of thing. So if you are in fact right that there are uses here that require that much more parking than anyone's been thinking about at this point, in theory that would still be available to you, but even in the scenario that you described. So. Yes, sir.
I want to applaud the flexibility of thinking, and it sounds like you guys have really gone through a lot of different scenarios and really the permanence of the historical value of the buildings. I can't get around the parking question, because if you got 36 units, let's say eventually brought in there, we're assuming at least one, possibly two cars, you said 72, 15, 72, let's say. And the other, what I asked earlier, how many parking spaces there were, you pointed to over by the children's, I forget what it's called, the little children's college. Or over the Mill Pond Diner parking lot. But aren't those private? Can we count on those for being available for public use?
I think if they were counted on, I think it would only be on a limited basis for some sort of peak usage. I think when we were running our numbers, we were thinking of these as maybe being half spaces per unit, which is pretty standard for a multifamily kind of use. And that was also partially why we mentioned the notion of expanding on the parking just in this one location. I don't know what our final numbers were, but it's over 100 spaces at that point. So the residential use is using less than half of the parking spaces. Those remaining 50 parking spaces are basically available for two cafes and a kayak rental spot on a day-to-day basis. So again, I think
you're talking about a venue, like a wedding coming in, or like a car show. Just is it between the people who work there and the people coming in? There's something tremendous there.
Yeah, so I think you would have to be careful to balance out those things in terms of, like, if there's a wedding, it's probably on a Sunday, and maybe that's when those other uses are closed, or, for the car show, those businesses maybe are closed, so that's probably the one day they really want to be open, but that's when you count the satellite kind of situation. I was mentioning how this yard space, there's actually another 20 spaces available in there, so that if there was a wedding that needed those extra spaces, that's just not the day that the cafe is putting out their tables. So there's a mix. Definitely a parking management scenario that's required. And I think the point between that and the restrooms, there are a lot of really fine-grained details that really need to be worked out as this thing really becomes real and some of these pieces fall into place. You have to be a little bit adaptable and loose. But again, from a conceptual standpoint, again, we're doing the numbers and we're trying to talk about realistic development potential here. We think we're suggesting something that's viable. It's not high in the sky. It wasn't, let's put 400 units here. They'll all be using Ubers anyway, so we won't worry about parking.
I think it's again that roadmap of the use plan. So in the evolution of it, if parking was a problem, I think everyone would be thrilled that parking became a problem here because there's so much activity and use. The two lower apartment buildings may be raised on podium, which means you park a lot. If the site evolves to that point that it can support that, wonderful. And if it doesn't, those wouldn't be able to be permitted because the other uses need the parking, and it just wouldn't make sense for the client. So it's more of that roadmap. And in the case that it's overparked all the time because there's so much activity, I think that's wonderful, and most objectives are well met at that point.
Just to that point, we did figure out parking in Onset, sort of, kind of. So this is pretty much small potatoes compared to the issues we face there, and, you know, the intensity of use versus the amount of parking space. So I would suggest that while there may be limits to what you can park on site, there are the ancillary areas around that. We have to reach agreements with the owners, but there's also plenty of municipal parking down on Merchants Way. There's plenty of parking at the town hall, especially on the weekends when nobody's working. We have a good relationship with the local transit authority. Their director is actually serves on the Beach and Tourism Committee that I started, and he's offered many times to help the town out with getting people around. So if it comes to that, I think we can move the people fairly well.
If you have big events, you can have shuttles.
Exactly.
Or you could even park, if you've got a big event going on here, or wedding here, you could park inside the Nail Factory building. So you could open it up and get cars. I mean, I think you can be really clever about trying to solve those.
Is that what you can on the back of the flat charts? Yes, ma'am.
With all seriousness about the buildings, not the one in the front that you just mentioned about reservation of purposes. The other two buildings, they're close to floodplain FEMA, that in the design, they probably have some time to think about future use or worry about parking. But all these buildings, tenants, we have parking underneath. So, like, for instance, the canal in Wareham has built these cargoes and parking big garages. That was the initial plan. So that's the way that issue. And then they have other spaces that are available for guests or other things. So it's a smaller footprint. It doesn't look so many cars. It keeps that open space look with trees and things like that. But if you do the garages correctly, I see that in Sandwich. They've done that on Tower Road in some of these condos. That possible for being able to splash, I don't know what you call it, but if the water were to rise, and in New Jersey, they go right through the garages. So I think that may eliminate the concerns for the parking for the residents.
Yeah, no, I think that's a good point. I think one thing to note here is that even these buildings are, the current elevation is at 14 versus where it needs to be is 15, so it's actually pretty close, which is good. I bet in a lot of those instances, they're much further into the floodplain, but that was the point that Eric was making. What you're suggesting is true as well. But if there was that much of a parking demand, you're right, you can technically park underneath of a building. There's a number of ways of doing that. So it's a costly solution, but if that's the real problem that you have out here, then that's great.
Well, it's more like addressing it up front in the early stages.
And I think that's where, again, imagine these are some of the last things coming online. We'll have a pretty good sense of what the real parking demand or constraints or challenges are with how the rest of the site has redeveloped. And so you haven't, you haven't built these yet, so you could think of them in the way you're talking about. Maybe they should be elevated. There should be parking there as part of that solution. So, yes, ma'am.
I just wondered if the contamination has been assessed yet.
I'll take that one on. There was an investigation done in 2015 into 2016. That was a phase one initial site investigation. Contamination was found. Our licensed site professional reported the town to the Department of Environmental Protection as is required by law. In order to assess exactly what's out there and to come up with a release abatement plan and figure out what to do with it, we're in the process now of devising a phase two comprehensive site assessment. One of the reasons for this feasibility study is because Mass Development redevelops brownfields. They don't just clean them up. In fact, at a meeting, they said, well, we need to know what you guys want to do with the property before we'll throw another $300,000 at you for the phase two comprehensive site assessment. And I looked at the person and said, well, yeah, you're not Mass Cleanup, you're Mass Development. And they said, exactly. So one of the big reasons that we're doing this is so that we can show Mass Development that we have worthy ideas for the site, that we have plans for the site, we're going to do something with it, we are going to redevelop in accordance with their mission, and then we're hopeful that we will receive the money to do the phase two comprehensive site assessment. Frankly, my knowledge of the site dates back to 2004 when the town bought it. I'm an environmental attorney. My mother was on the community preservation committee. She said, "What do you think?" I said, "Don't walk, run away." She said, "Why?" And I said, "It's skunked." She said, "How can you know?" I said, "You can't do what they did there for 150 years and not have contamination." And she was the only person on that committee to vote against it. As recently as 2013, I and another selectman were not averse to the idea of taking matches to the place. I was pleasantly surprised and heartened that the phase one initial site investigation didn't show the borderline Superfund site that I assumed was there. There is contamination, it does need to be addressed. We don't know exactly how that's going to happen. That will all come out from the phase two investigation and then in subsequent plan to address releases. There's techniques, including soil averaging and various things where sometimes you don't even have to disturb the site. There's other things, other sites that have done activity and use limitations. I'm sure the town would prefer to avoid those going forward, because that makes it harder to engage in human activities out there. But the short answer is we don't know what we're for.
So my question about that was the general time frame for assessing, and of course we don't know what you want to get to clean up if you do, but what's that general time frame?
Hey, why are you going to give us money?
So are
there maps? Here, finish this plan.
Are there maps that show where it is, or you don't know where the contamination is at this point?
We know where some of it is, but it's, you know, the DEP regulatory system is set up so that they don't want you acting on anything that isn't a quote imminent hazard until you know what the heck it is, where it is, and what to do about it. So
that's.
Well, we're hopeful that we can get this feasibility study done. We're hopeful that Mass Development will like it, and we're hopeful that they will approve our application for the funds. So I can't tell you exactly how fast that will go. It's just not going to happen. I'm not going to tell you that.
And I'll say intuitively, you know, I made a comment about pickling building. Pickling isn't putting nails in a jar of vinegar, which is what I thought it was. It's actually a very chemical intensive process for cleaning up the nails and so on and so forth. That's why we know that's probably the hottest of the hot spots on the site. You know, this was a building dating to 1970 when they probably weren't using lots of nasty stuff, which is why our sense is that probably this upper portion of the site is probably relatively clean, which is why it's a residential use. You talk about the activity use limitation. Residential is usually the one that's a definite no-no in the kind of contaminated area. So again, it also kind of further reinforces and supports the kind of uses that we're proposing. You know, renting kayaks out of a shed that maybe has some contamination, but it's been capped, it's probably not going to be a big deal. So our hope is that the kind of things we're proposing, now, a restaurant on top of a hotspot, maybe there's an issue there, but I think we'll kind of figure that out, find it out. It's all in how you remediate it, how far you have to take some of those measures. Maybe some of those things will ultimately determine that some of these things aren't possible in some of the specific locations we're coming for. But we think it's intuitively, it seems like it's going to work out. Mm-hmm.
I just didn't know if there was already maps showing what it is.
Hi. Yes. The answer is yes. The DEP has case files of all the remediation that was probably done between 1980 and 2000. They're PDF files, so you can go on the DEP site and look up 10 Elm Street.
Those were very limited. So to the extent that anybody's relying on a map from 2000 to figure out what's going on the site now, I wish they'd tell us that we saved $300,000 on a comprehensive phase two site assessment.
So when exactly was recently?
Phase one we recently did was filed in 2016. And that will be available on the DEP site.
Thank you.
Sure. Anyone else? Yes.
If this becomes a successful cultural arts, recreational, retail complex, which is the way that this thing is described, what is the thinking behind and or what is the value of introducing or adding residential uses?
The
intention was one. That was one of the larger needs that we thought we were hearing Wareham needs. So it's looking for, if you were going to do new construction, what could or would make sense here, and residential seemed to be the thing that surfaced. I think I would also suggest that most viable, successful places work best when there is that sort of 24-hour cycle of use. In other words, I don't think when we're talking about music performances, we're not thinking about, you know, like the Journey cover band that's playing till like 3 a.m. We're talking about, you know, like a jazz concert in the afternoon. And I think the notion of there being people that live here so that when the rest of this empties out, that's when they're kind of getting home and walking their dogs. And those are the kind of things that I think support that sort of 24-hour use and security and safety. But that might not be a real issue here. And I guess if in the end this stuff all goes completely gangbusters and it does become this huge cultural resource and people are coming really very much for those uses, again, long term, if it makes more sense to build a brand new children's museum there because that's what makes sense, then great. I think for us it was, given what we know about the market, given our general sense of just wanting to balance those uses, given the fact that most of what's around this site is residential, it felt like introducing new residential, albeit at a higher density than a lot of the surrounding context, was the thing that made the most sense. But again, that's given what we know today and what we think is going to happen here over time.
So I tend to agree, well, I do agree with you about the 24/7 piece of how that helps a site develop. I guess my thinking of it is because of its location and residential uses already around it, one of my hopes for this redevelopment is that it would help invigorate redevelopment from Center Park Green down towards downtown and see some reinvestment in the residential properties that currently exist. And adding the new residential here, there was very little discussion about the railroad and its impact on residential. So most of the houses now that are on Main Street pull away from the railroad tracks, but these potential new units would be right on the railroad tracks. And I don't know what the impact is in terms of that. Now, I didn't know whether or not it makes it more financially viable to have them. But it seems like we have a lot of residential around, and it would be nice to see the encouragement of redevelopment of that and or new construction along the street.
Yeah, and I think our hope is that in any scenario, what happens when I'm on the site, that the redevelopment of this will spill over and provide an impetus for other parcels in the context to redevelopment improvement. Again, I think we didn't want to consider additional retail, because again, Merchants Way has plenty of availability in retail.
Okay,
and even with cultural uses, we were wondering if we were already kind of pushing the upper limit of how many spaces might be needed. But again, if somebody, I guess if there's a need for a brand new theater in Wareham, could you make a case here maybe?
I guess that part of the discussion leads to a question for Eric, in that, you know, what is the demand for event space? Like, if we have, and I'm not suggesting that we don't have the demand for it, but I don't know, like, we have Town Place Suites, which is new event space. We have Box Mill Hall, which is kind of similar to the character of what you're talking about here for event space and venues.
That would be part of our job, is to create demand for people to come to town and enjoy events, and other people like us.
Well, I think
that's a big part of it. The event here is somewhat driven by the physical setting of the building and of the setting, where the program, the people who are actually going to make something happen, are going to be what makes the event space attractive. In the same way that in the temporary use of the metal building, the programming, whoever becomes that organizing entity that really pulls people together and creates something beyond just opening doors and saying we're renting a space for X dollars per space, is going to make it happen. And so, you know, again, it's that idea of creating that place, creating something that's going on there, using this as an organizing tool to do that. And the housing was, as we've seen in a lot of other places, something that adds that level of stability. And we think it does by planting the people there. If you create a place where people want to be, then the demand is there. If we look at the rental housing locally, there isn't a lot.
back a little bit more. You see that the larger developments that are either happening or have happened in recent years are larger, have a lot of amenities, and maybe the Pine Hills, where they have kind of a high-end product on golf course, the Mashpee Commons, which is around the Commons, all the dining and entertainment there. What we're looking at here is a very smaller scale look at, if you create this great place, do people eventually, as we see in a lot of places, eventually want to stay there? And if so, financially that's great, fiscally that's great, it brings in some tax value, social value to go up, but also that stability piece. It sort of connects the dots and missing teeth here. And you start to have really kind of the bookend that Jeremy started in the beginning, where Green Street extends from here all the way down to the park on the other end. It's a mix of people living, retail, cultural, all that stuff together. Does that answer your question?
I think the real answer is we did our best looking into our crystal ball, what made sense here long term. Now again, what long term even means could be, you know, when I asked that question, which I was glad, you know.
Yeah, actually I just have one last question, yeah. Probably directed more towards Peter and Derek. In terms of short term and long term thinking, what are the thoughts about the ownership structure of the property? Like, is it the plan for long term for it always to be owned by the town, or currently it's owned by the town?
Well, currently it is owned by the town. It was acquired with community preservation money. It would be difficult to do anything more than set up long-term leases for the property. I think it would be difficult to convey it away just because it was bought in that fashion. I don't think there's any particular interest on our part to convey it away. I could say that going forward, if a master developer of means and ability and who could fit in with our vision of what's supposed to take place out there were to come along, we would certainly welcome working with such a person, but it would probably be under the ownership of the town.
Okay. Yes. Kind of to expound upon one of the other gentlemen's comments about being in other places and visiting other places. One place that has been very successful with gardens and older homes is Strawberry Bank in Boston, New Hampshire. So that might be another aspect of these other homes, if there could be a long-term plan for our historic homes in town, if they are affected by development. So that was one thing that might be a consideration. Just to put beautiful gardens in. Heritage Plantation is putting a whole six-cent garden area.
I forgot to respond back about the railroad proximity.
Yeah, yeah.
Valid point. New construction, there's certainly techniques for minimizing, mitigating the sounds. So it's a challenge, but there are certainly approaches to resolving that challenge. And in some ways, these buildings might also help to sort of buffer some of the sound. And the sense I get that it's not that the train is going by every 10 minutes either. You know, it is a periodic thing that does occur. But I think the hope is that it would be, certainly from within the units, there's ways of mitigating that. Now, if you were sitting up and reading the book, you know, yeah, the train might blow by every once in a while, but you're going to definitely hear it. But I think there's ways of resolving the noise issue, at least within the units.
There's another fact that we haven't spoken about on the housing. Part of what we heard in the stakeholder discussions was about population demographics. And we heard over and over again that the desire to have younger people have a place to live, or a desire to sort of stay or to come back. And then we heard that there's what's going on at Wareham Crossing, and there's a lot of kind of medical office space, a lot of activity happening. You know, does this offer an alternative for that sort of younger workforce type resident to start to kind of creep back in this direction? And we think that from what we've heard, and we've seen in other places, that demographic is worth trying to reach out to and sort of pull in some younger folks. And we think this could be a good avenue. There tends to be a gravity around things that are cultural places, artist places, and eventually evolving people saying, oh, I'd love to live here, whether it becomes you know, 12-unit building or an 8-unit building that has an artist lived workspace or maker lived workspace. I think, again, it's that framework that allows us to sort of lay out and see what happens.
Yes?
Go back to the railroad question. That's really good. This is more for long-term because I know the town is very interested in having the commuter rail come down here more often than just the summer. We would love to be a stop. And so, being that I was a commuter from Wareham to Boston for 6 years, those trains run every hour from 5 a.m. to 11, and then peak hours for 10 o'clock at night. So, is that something that we're also considering? Because those people are not going to hear these trains go by every few hours during the night.
Well, I can tell you that in Quincy at one point, I had a condo that was right on the red line, and those condos are selling for about $300,000 now. People become acclimated to the noise, and believe me, the red line comes a heck of a lot. We wouldn't get commuter rail every hour down here, I can tell you that. We'd be lucky to get two or three trains, you know, leaving and then going. I don't see that as a huge impediment. You know, as was mentioned, there are ways you can do noise barriers to really knock the noise back quite a bit. If you're bringing people in too, also people who've grown up in the city, they don't sleep when it's quiet. That's when they can't sleep. Country people can't sleep when it's noisy out. So it really depends on who you get into the tenants to some extent too, as to who's bothered by it and who isn't.
And again, I think the trade-offs, right? So suddenly if there's a commuter rail, that means more noise from the train, but that also means access to the city. So, you know, like now it maybe draws from a different crowd. Maybe it's no longer empty nesters, oh, the noise, but now it's young kids that are like, I can ride my bike down to the stop and ride it. Yeah. Yeah.
It all depends on what people want. Some people like living close to a main road because they can hop on it and, you know, get going with it. I don't. Some people are perfectly comfortable living on main thoroughfares with cars going by all night. I'm not. Does the train that I hear every morning go by, you know, Wolf's Whistle, 622 near my house? Does it wake me up? Not usually. It's, you know, within 300 yards, 400 yards. It makes a little bit of noise, but, you know, no place that we build or no place that we have someone else build is going to appeal to everyone. And I think that if we try to make it appealable to the most people possible, then we'll have done the best job we can. And the other thing too is, if we're only talking about 36 units, we're not looking at a massive development where we have to draw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of tenants.
Yeah, and I think the real draw here is going to be, in theory, all the activity that's already going on here as well. So if you think you're finding a quiet, you know, place in the country, it's not here for sure. So you've got trains on one side, jazz concerts on the other side.
That's what Rochester is for.
To just revisit the kind of time frame, given your ability to read it first of all and your experiences, what sort of frame are you looking for short term and long
term? You want to take that? That sounds like one of your questions.
Like a crystal ball. Well, I think the first step we're talking about. The time frame. I think that organizing piece that we spoke of earlier, you know, if there starts to be or if there's an existing group that says that music venue is perfect, we need a little help in figuring out how to do it, but how do we start to do it with this plan? With, we keep playing the mass development, you know, Zed left. If now you have the framework and the scaffolding of a plan, now it's organization around them. Who's doing it, how are we going to do it. So starting those conversations around this plan, starting with those big picture items. If the metal building in the short term is to be used by artists, who's going to pick up that until we're done with it? Same with the main building. You know, how is that going to work if it's to be that concert venue? And let's start to work on that within the kind of confined scaffolding here.
Well, we can give you an answer right there too, because depending upon how the space is conformed, every season is what we do. We take the artists that are coming in, the spaces that we want to work in and see what's coming up a season or two or three. If we know there's a big venue coming, we'll bring the orchestra in.
Yeah, and to speak to that point and reinforce what Eric was saying too, I think a lot of it depends on how many local champions you can get. In other words, I think the project that we see take off the quickest are ones where a lot of people, you know, grassroots kind of come in and take on their portion of it. If you're counting on Peter and Derek and Ken to take this thing and run with it, you know, it'll take longer than if suddenly there's 10, 20 volunteers that are coming at it from how do we program the music spaces? How do we get, you know, the kayak rental thing business going? How do we, you know, you're going to find somebody come out of the woodwork. Wait, I heard something about you guys want a microbrewery here? I want to build a microbrewery here. Great, help us figure out how to build a microbrewery here. So a lot of that time frame is going to depend on how many people you get involved. It's going to depend on some of these regulatory challenges, that 50% constraint. You know, can we get past that? Where's the money going to come from? You know, how quickly can you get some funds from mass development? They're not going to be able to do all the funding. So, you know, bringing a doc online, that's a grant. Who's going to write for that grant? So I think there's a, it's multi-layered. It's complex to say, you know, to understand it. But I think I've seen that the places that it goes quickest is when a number of local people get involved and champion some little aspect of it, like it's their baby, and they run with that one thing, and three of those things going at once really starts to create some synergy. So
in the long-term plan, when we start talking about new construction and really some sort of heavy lifting, I think it's all dependent on that first phase. So if there's a lot of activity, a group hub comes out and says, wow, all this is happening, we want to be here, to Jeremy's point, then suddenly, as a developer and a developer consultant, I have clients coming to me saying, "What? How do we get our hands on the apartment building? This is going to be an active spot. It's going to be very attractive." And we'll start to collapse that time frame from a decade long to 3 to 5 years. It really depends on that activity level.
Yes, ma'am.
You said the kayak company
coming
in one of those buildings
pretty
soon. They're
already in here, actually.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So is that building that fits, or?
No, they have a new back door, I guess, if you will. They've installed a set of stairs and a little platform to walk in and out. They've got their boats in there, and what they've done is they've actually taken a large rope and run it across, as if to say, this is mine. It's like a little, it's like two little kids in a room or something. You know, this is my space, the rest is our space. So they've already taken a chunk of the building and have the kayaks in there. They're just waiting for, you know, the weather to cooperate so they can open up.
So that's the only building that's usable?
That's the only building that's in use. I wouldn't say usable, I would say in use.
That was a perfect use for just like a restaurant. You can't just kind of slide in. But something like kayak rentals, they probably have the little thing on their phone where they run the credit card, and that was as much as they needed for setup. They have their boats and they've got their smartphones. So I mean, it may be that there's other people out there that have that simpler, easier means of coming up. That's why I think the artist studio's thought keeps resonating, because I think people assume, gosh, an artist, all he wants is to keep the rain off his stuff. Like, that's literally, you know, that's as much as they require the rest of it. So, like, in the short term, again, finding people that can really seamlessly just kind of come in.
And that's, you know, if we're going to close, I guess, you know, that's kind of what I wanted to speak to tonight was, you know, I'm glad that everybody came out tonight to hear this. I think it's important. But don't just leave here and forget about the place. We're committed as a town government going forward, cleaning up the site, redeveloping it, seeing what takes place. Jeremy spoke earlier about getting people engaged. We already have people engaged. One of the omissions, I guess, that I should have caught in the beginning when we had the team was we failed to mention our citizen advisors. These are people who've worked with Ken Buckland and I to review some of these plans, make suggestions, even come up with a lot of what you've seen tonight before you. And those three people were Rose Berry of Eastern Bank, the branch manager, Maria Oliva, who is the president of the Cape Cod Canal Region Chamber of Commerce. She was also unable to be here tonight. So the spotlight falls on Tracy Medeiros of the Gallery Consignment Shop. She was one of the three people who got us involved, or got involved in this very early on. The three ladies have been extremely helpful. And going forward, they've already come up with plans to host a couple of events out there this summer. They don't know exactly what they're going to be. They could be dinner parties, they could be musical events. I'm sure Tracy's being lobbied right now by the Whipples. And these events would take place under the aegis, if you will,
of the Cape Cod Canal Region Chamber, so they don't even have to go to the step of setting up their own 501c3 to do this. Rio Leva has already agreed to get involved on that level. In fact, she wants people in town to know that if you want to do events, she's willing to serve as the umbrella for it. So that was an interesting thing to learn, that they don't just do their own events. For those of us who went to the Oyster Festival this weekend, that was a production. So that gives you a sense of the scale of the things that they can pull off and handle. But we're very grateful to our advisors, and they will be included in the final draft that we get done. Beyond that, you know, as they said, Derek and I aren't going to get this done by ourselves. Ken's not going to get it done by himself. You know, we take the plan that they come up with, and we use that as our guide. And one of the important distinctions, I think, that we need to make between the last $50,000 study of this property in 2009 and this one is that the last time out, they told us everything we could do. In addition to telling us the shape of buildings, they told us everything that we could do with it. What we needed was somebody to tell us what we should do with it. And that's what these people are giving us. That's what you people are giving us in coming out here and telling us what to do. We're not going to come up with this stuff on our own. We're not that bright. So we need the help of everybody. And I hope everybody will stay engaged going forward on this.